My life is mine, and I form it. Tell yourself this often. There is no condition that you cannot change. Except one, indisputably, physically accepted at birth. The condition that you have been born. But everything else, even the material world or everything, consciousness is not bound to matter. We will break through. And I'm so much looking forward for that. After, yeah, digitalizing here, what is so, so important, and everyone can, in his own reality, then grasp it and get it, and as it will somehow arrive to everyone in any incarnation. And then, yeah, you go the way of enlightenment, what literally means to, in the end, get transparent and be filled with light and create all light and spectrum and dimensions and realities and everything out of yourself. But conscious, it will not just happen to you. You know then, and you know how to control it and how creation there, out of intensity and playfulness and joy and all this excited state feelings emerges and comes into place. Thus, on the vibratory nature of existence. You understand that there are spectrums of light. So are there spectrums of matter. Your system of physical reality is not dense in comparison with some others. Some systems are far heavier or lighter than your own, though this may not involve weight in the terms with which you are familiar. You are used to thinking in single-line thoughts. So you think of events that you know as complete things or actions, not realizing that what you perceive is but a fraction of their entire multidimensional existence. In greater terms, it is impossible to separate one physical event from the probable event, for these are all dimensions of one action. So again, the dimension of one action has many probable events. It is basically impossible to separate the you that you know from the probable yous of which you are unaware, for the same reasons. There are always inner pathways, however, leading between probable events. Since all of them are manifestations of an act in its becoming. All events are manifestations of an act in its becoming. You are also in a state of becoming. And then the dimensions are illusions. And it's just the in-between between that the steps in your consciousness happened. They span the time between it. The physical brain alone cannot pick up these connections with any great success. The mind, which is the inner counterpart of the brain, can at times perceive far greater dimensions of any given event through a burst of sudden intuition or comprehension that cannot be adequately described on a verbal level. As I said frequently, time as you think does not exist. Yet in your terms, time's true nature could be understood if the basic nature of the atom was ever made known to you. In one way, an atom could be compared to a microsecond. It seems as if an atom exists steadily for a certain amount of time. Instead, it phases in and out, so to speak. It fluctuates in a highly predictable pattern and rhythm. It can be perceived within your system only at certain points in this fluctuation. So it seems to scientists that the atom is steadily present. Yet it's a pulse. Everything is pulsating. It's just very, very fast going on. This is what you can see eye to eye in Salvia Divinorum, how everything is 100,000 times sparkling out of itself and pulsating. The scientists are not aware of any graphs of absence, as far as the atom is concerned. In those periods of non-physical projection, the off periods of fluctuation, the atoms appear in another system of reality. In that system, they are perceived in what are on points of fluctuation, and in that system, also then the atoms appear steadily. There are many such points of fluctuation, but your system is of course not aware of them, nor the ultimate actions, universes and systems that exist with them. Now the same sort of behavior occurs on a deep, basic, secret and unexplored psychological level. Your psyche, you are pulsating and you're switching into all dimensions anytime simultaneously, you just cannot yet perceive it. The physically oriented consciousness, you will can perceive it once your body own multidimensional neurotransmitter opens up and you produce it body's own via your pineal gland, your first eye, body own DMT, and you can produce masses of it every day and every month. This is where evolution goes. The physically oriented consciousness responding to one phase of the atom's activity comes alive and awake to its particular existence. But in between are other fluctuations in which consciousness is focused upon entirely different systems of reality. Each of these coming awake and responding, and each one having no sense of absence and memory only of those particular fluctuations to which they respond. And here come excerpts from the Thess material, another best of collection that is here in this wonderful best of the best ofs by Jane Roberts and Robert Butts, and of course by Seth. It is everything that is written here was one-to-one channeled in trance. We're individualized portions of energy, materialized within physical existence, to learn to form ideas from energy and make them physical. This is idea construction. We project ideas into an object so that we can deal with it. But the object is the thought materialized. This physical representation of idea permits us to learn the difference between the I, who thinks, and the thought. Idea construction teaches the I what it is by showing its own products in a physical manner. We learn by viewing our own creations, in other words. We learn the power and effects of ideas by changing them into physical realities. And we learn responsibility in the use of creative energy. The entity is the basic self, immortal, non-physical. It communicates on an energy level with other entities and has an almost inexhaustible supply of energy at its command. The individual is the portion of the whole self that we manage to express physically. The I projects and focuses the inner image, idea, onto the physical world in the same manner that a motion picture camera transfers an image onto a screen. The mouth creates words. The ears create sound. The difficulty in understanding this principle is due to the fact that we have taken it for granted that the image and sound already exist for the senses to interpret. Yet it's vice versa. Actually, the senses are the channels of creation, by which idea is projected into material expression. Therefore, if you shut off the senses, then you can create in other dimensions. If you use your ears in your eyes create pictures and images, your ears create sound. This is a perspective change. We create with our senses. The basic idea is that the senses are developed not to permit awareness of an already existing world, but to create it. The subconscious is the threshold of ideas' emergence into the individual conscious mind. It connects the entity and the individual. The physical body is the material construction of the entity's idea of itself, under the properties of matter. Instinct is the minimum ability for idea construction, necessary for physical survival. The present is the apparent point of any idea's emergence into physical matter. Thoughts and images are formed into physical reality and become physical fact. They are propelled chemically. A thought is energy. It begins to produce itself physically at the moment of its conception or inception. You can also not tell if it is your thought or if it is not your thought. It already existed in the timeless zero continuum. You just get ideas out of there and they come to you, but they have been already there. Mental enzymes are connected with the pineal gland. As you know them, body chemicals are physical, but they are the propellants of this thought energy, containing all the codified data necessary for translating any thought or image into physical actuality. They cause the body to reproduce the inner image. They're sparks, so to speak, initiating the transformation. Chemicals are released through the skin and pore systems in an invisible but definite pseudo-physical formation. The intensity of a thought or image largely determines the immediacy of its physical materialization. It's the intensity. There is no object about you that you have not created. There is nothing about your own physical image that you have not made. The initial thought or image exists within the mental enclosure. It is not yet physical. Then it is sparked into physical materialization by the mental enzymes. This is the general procedure. All such images and thoughts are not completely materialized in your terms, however. The intensity may be too weak. The chemical reaction sparks certain electrical charges, some within the layers of the skin. There are radiations then through the skin to the exterior world, containing highly codified instructions and information. The physical environment is much a part of you as your body. Your control over it is quite effective, for you create it as you create your fingertip. Objects are composed of the same pseudo-material that radiates outward from your own physical image. Only the higher intensity mass is different for objects. When it is built up enough, you recognize it as an object. A low intensity mass is not apparent to you. not with your normal senses, but with your higher ones, your inner ones. Every nerve and fiber within the body has an inner purpose that allows the inner self to create physical reality. In one respect, the body and physical objects go flying out in all directions from the inner core of the whole self. Nerve impulses travel outward from the body, invisibly along these nerves' pathways, in much the same manner that they travel within the body. The pathways are carriers of telepathic thoughts, impulses, and desires that travel outward from any given self, altering seemingly objective events. Nothing is objective, everything is formed out of consciousness. Indeed, objective and subjective are the same, because you are the measuring station and the torus that creates it at the same time. In your system of reality, you are learning what mental energy is and how to use it. You do this by constantly transforming your thoughts and emotions into physical form. You are supposed to get a clear picture of your inner development by perceiving the exterior environment. What seems to be a perception, an objective concrete event independent from you, is instead the materialization of your own inner emotions, energy, and mental environment. You must watch the pictures that you paint with your imagination. Your environment and the conditions of your life at any given time are the direct result of your own inner expectations. You create your own difficulties. This is true for each individual. The inner psychological state is projected outward, gaining physical reality. And this regardless of the nature of the psychological state. The rules apply to everyone. You can use them for your own benefit and change your own conditions once you realize what they are. Greater Self. If you sell yourself short, you will say, "I am a physical organism and I live within the boundaries of my environment." If you do not sell yourself short, you will say, "I am an individual. I form my physical environment. I change and make my world. I am free of space and time. I am part of all that is. There is no place within me where creativity does not exist." Here follow excerpts, best ofs, from Thess, Dreams and Projection of Consciousness. Man's ego causes him to interpret everything in light of himself. He loses much in this manner. The ego can be compared to the bark of a tree. The bark is flexible, vibrant, and grows with the growth beneath. It's a tree's contact with the outer world, the tree's interpreter, and, to some degree, the tree's companion. So should man's ego be. When man's ego turns instead into a shell, when instead of interpreting outside conditions, it reacts too violently against them, then it hardens and becomes an imprisoning form that begins to snuff out important data and to keep enlarging information from the inner self. The ego's purpose is protective. The ego is also a device to enable the inner self to inhabit the physical plane. And when the ego dies and is dissolved, then you're not anymore in any physical plane. You can dematerialize and you can have this literal experience in deep, double deep ayahuasca state. The ego should not react so violently that it remembers and reacts to past storms in the midst of a clear and sunny weather. About psychological time. Within any given 5 minutes of clock of time, for example, you may find an hour of rest, which is independent of clock time. And here a tip about dreams and dream locations. Examine dream locations carefully. First, dream locations that represent places familiar to you in your present daily life. Then, dream locations that represent places, such as foreign countries, to which you have never have really traveled. Then, dream locations that represent definite places that appear as they were in past. If you dream of your childhood home as it was, not as it is now, then the location would belong in this category. Then, dream locations that represent places that no longer exist physically. Then, strange, completely unfamiliar dream locations. And instinct dream locations. As well as strange dream locations to which you keep returning. This is what you should examine, the locations, because the location is symbolizing you. The electricity that is perceivable within your system is merely a projection of a vast electrical system that you cannot perceive. Yet the inner self offers so many clues. It operates outside of physical references. It is of itself, free of the distorted effects peculiar to the physical system. A study of dreams, for example, would make many of these points clear. Dream locations have not only a psychological reality, but a definite actuality. A study of dream locations is most important. Dream locations are composed of electrical mass, density and intensity. Definite work may be done in a dream, but the physical arms and legs are not tired. This would seem contrary to your known laws, but no one has looked into this. It is most difficult to even hint at the myriad complexity and dimension of the electrical actuality as it exists. Each of your own thoughts is composed of a unique intensity of impulse, shared by nothing else. That the same way may be said for every dream you will have in your lifetime, and that all your experiences gather together in particular ranges of intensity they cluster through and by intensity. Again, completely unique. And the summation of all that you are exists in 1 minute range or band of intensities. Then you see how difficult this is to explain in words. This not only applies to your physical field, but also to all others. Your field is contained within its own range of intensities. A tiny band of electrical impulses, a million times smaller than one note picked at a random from the entire mass of musical composition that ever has been written or ever will be written. I'm not going too deeply into this, because you are not yet ready. But because of the infinite range of intensities available, each individual has limitless intensities within which he can move. All motion is mental or psychological motion, and all mental or psychological motion has its electrical reality. The inner self moves by moving through intensities. Each new experience opens up a new pulsation intensity. To move through intensities within the electrical system gives the result in the physical field of moving through time. We are actually moving through intensities within the electrical system, like the nerves and in your brain tips. It's all electromagnetical information change that happens 100,000 times. These unconscious body functions. And it's the same for your existence in respect to the higher entity that you are. This is how you work for it. All versions and possibilities of each event must be actualized in the limitless multiplication of creativity. Any one moment in physical time is a warp, opening into these other dimensions of actuality. And one moment can be used as a passageway or bridge. The act of crossing will be reflected in a million other worlds. But these reflections will be themselves alive, and the act of perceiving itself will create still another vortex of actualization. So greatly how it is described. It's, yeah, of course it is like this, how nerves and information works electromagnetically, and you're nothing but information. Slide imaginatively into a world where you do not perform the next small action you will perform in this world. Cough, smile, sneeze. In some other actuality, your actions are non-actions, and your non-acts are realized. That is deep. In some other actuality, your actions are non-actions, and your non-acts are realized. About projection of fears and guilts onto probable personalities. Once you realize that your guilt is groundless, then it can dissolve. It is only when you become frightened that you project it in such a way. Learn secondary responses. The inner senses alone are equipped to process and perceive other reality systems. Even the distortions and distractions can be kept at a minimum with training. Development of the inner senses is a method of perceiving other realities, and followed correctly, the ego is not only stronger, but more flexible. Yeah, much more flexible. It can change from dissolvement into knowing about itself that it is the surface tension that creates this skin of the reality you perceive. Even consciousness of physical reality is increased. The root assumptions are so a part of your existence that they cloud your dreams. Beneath them, however, portions of the self perceive physical reality in an entirely different fashion, free from the tyranny of objects and physical form. Portions of the self perceive physical reality in an entirely different fashion, free of the tyranny of objects and physical form. Here, your experience concepts directly without the needs for symbols. All that surrounds you are symbols. And you don't need this in dimensions and worlds and realities that are not necessarily materialized. It is not the norm, physical realities. Even though we may think it is the norm, but there are realities that are non-material and they don't know that material realities like ours exist. Yeah, this was in part one of this large collection of best ofs. Yeah, soon we're done, but some more pages. Verse being read. The primary dream experience is finally woven into a structure composed of these assumptions. And it is these you remember. These serve you as basic information, but the information is in symbolic form. Objects are symbols. Dream objects are often symbols of realities that the ego could not perceive otherwise. Time and space are both a part of something else. They are merely the camouflage patterns by which you perceive reality. Time and space are camouflage. Tarnung. Space, as you perceive it in the dream state, comes much closer to reality. The dream universe is obviously closely connected with your own, since pseudo objects are present. Within the dream state, you are in the outward areas of the physical-oriented universe. There are other systems all about and within your own. The undifferentiated areas move out like spirals through all reality. Little resistance is encountered within them. They represent inner roads that connect systems as well as divide them. The dream states, which are outward areas of the physical-oriented universe. It is possible, theoretically, to travel to any system in this manner and bypass others. Most of the knowledge gained escapes the ego, and the experiences cannot be translated by the physical brain. Some of the data would be retained by inner portions of the self. In a creative individual, some of this information might be symbolically expressed in a painting or other work of art. Each brush stroke of a painting represents concentrated experience and compressed perceptions. True motion has nothing to do with space. The only real motion is that of the traveling consciousness. I love this. True motion has nothing to do with space. The only real motion is that of the traveling consciousness. More thus extracts and best ofs. Gleaned from various sources. Sense of play. On the one hand, you take life too seriously. And on the other, you do not take playful existence seriously enough. Death. Now, for those of you who are lazy, I can offer no hope. Death will not bring you an eternal resting place. You may rest, if this is your wish, for a while. Not only must you use your abilities after death, however, but you must face up to yourself for those that you did not use. But you must face up to yourself for those that you did not use during your previous existence. You will learn it. This awesome creaturehood and beingship. And there is no state of stagnation that can happen. Everything is just for a period. Sleep and dreaming. Your normal consciousness can benefit by excursions and adventures, and rest in those other fields of actuality that are entered when you sleep. And the so-called sleeping consciousness will also benefit by frequent excursions into the waking state. Reality creation. As I have told you before, in a manner of speaking, you are given the gifts of the gods. Your beliefs become reality. What you believe is and becomes real in your experience. There is no area in your life to which this does not apply. Spontaneity says this. So the only constant of this multidimensional life is spontaneity. In basic terms, civilization is dependent upon the spontaneity and fulfillment of the individual. Your civilization is in sad straits. Not because you're allowed spontaneity or fulfillment to individuals, but because you denied it. We have a schedule plan that really permits and avoids every kind of spontaneity. You have to be from 8 to 5 o'clock in the work and have to do this, and then you have to drive to shop, and then you have to this, and you have to react in this way and in this way, and just do something unexpected. Behave like your life was a movie, then you would behave unexpected and maximum spontaneous. Seth concept. Yeah, here comes kind of prelude. And this is written by someone else. Not Jane Roberts. Jane Roberts did what she did. She made group sessions out of it that others also learned to channel Seth. And therefore, there exists much more Seth material as just that from Jane Roberts. But for my part of existence, it's enough to have been through all that Jane Roberts released, or almost all, and combine ayahuasca, and from there you can travel anywhere. And yeah, what is the last puzzle piece for me is this Thoth material, and it will be as exciting and unleashing as this is on a more specific manner. Concerning real, what is my goal? It is to dematerialize, to teleport, to switch into different bodies, to shapeshift, to really get a 100% creator in all multidimensional universe that you are. And this is a perfect guide on how this way works. Okay, here this Seth concept is written by Andy Huggs. Jane Roberts, the author of the book The Seth Material, was a person who, in a trance state, spoke as a personality called Seth. Jane sometimes goes into a different trance state where she speaks as future Seth. Also, in the first books, there's not only Seth channel, but also a character who calls himself Seth too. This is very interesting. He's a different kind of speaking. You really recognize that this is the character above and beyond Seth. Very nicely. It's only some short. I have only done it in German up to now. You will find it. And here is another one channel that is, he calls himself Future Seth. Many manifestations of this tree of personalities. All of the answers and informations herein are the words of Seth, or future Seth, which I have, this Andy Huggs, which I have recorded and revised to give continuity to my understanding of the material. I highly recommend Seth and Jane's books. There's also one great book of Jane Roberts where she describes several methods on how to channel and how to hypnotize and how to go into these other dimensions very easily just by sitting down and maybe someone who helps and what to concentrate upon. And so you can make regular sessions where you connect to these higher entities and have these sessions. This is not one person on this earth that were gifted to do this work, to get all this inspiration and direct words that do not come out of your ego-based mind, but really out of, it was not your idea, you would say, but it came to you. And there's also in the internet SaaS networks and a dedicated SaaS www page, SaaS Network Intel International, I think it means. Check out if you're deeper interested. Beyond myself, there is another self, and still another, of which I am aware. And that self tells you that there is a reality beyond human reality and experience that cannot be made verbal or translated into human terms. And to that self, physical reality is like a warm breath forming in the winter air. Future Thess speaks about the nature and purpose of communications. Names are arbitrary, and we use them merely for our convenience. Seth's name or mine isn't important. Individuality is important and continues in ways you do not suspect. Seth is learning as I am. As an analogy, you could call me a future Seth, at a higher state of development. However, both of us are fully independent and exist simultaneously. My personality is far different than his, but I am also a friend. In many ways, I am the same friend. Other portions of me are concerned elsewhere, for I am aware of my existence in other dimensions and keep track of them and direct my many selves. This experience I can also tell about. In the 7D deep ayahuasca experience, you feel yourself literally 1,000 times split up, and you feel yourself in many parallel realities acting. And in many worlds and realities, you feel the essence of what your many selves are just in this moment, are acting, what their effect is, what their impulse and their thrive is. It is so great. It is golden dropping. I have to make this Suvuya audiobook. There, these multidimensional deep DMT space are so wonderfully described. It is an adventure story. You will love it. It is much more, not so theoretical, describing analytic stuff like this one. I know it is sometimes hard to follow it, and you have to hear it again and again to fall not asleep maybe, or not get bored. And the other one is really an adventure story that will arouse a lot of feelings in you, and it's quite different, but both has its importance to get installed in different ways in your consciousness. Alright, so this future Seth and Seth also is simultaneously aware of all the selves in many, many realities. We are Seth. And whenever we have spoken, we have been known as Thess. We are not alone in this endeavor, for through your centuries, other entities like us have also appeared and spoken. Our entity is composed of multitudinous selves, with their own identities, many of whom have worked in this behalf. Their message will always be basically the same. Though the times and circumstances of their communications may differ and be colored accordingly. So I am also one of the Seth characters. Seth Kess. One of these color paintbrushes. So here the quality is a little bit less, as I use a phone to record, and you will adapt. We adopt whatever personality characteristics seem pertinent. For in our own reality, we have a bank of complete inner selves, and we are all thus. we attempt to translate realities into terms that you can comprehend. We change our face and form, but we are always the one. Many of us have not been born in flesh, as I have not been. But in one way we have seeded ourselves through endless universes. Our basic knowledge and energy automatically reaches out to nourish all systems that grow. You're like children with a game, and you think that the game is played by everyone. Physical life is not the rule. Consciousness is the force behind matter, and it forms many other realities besides the physical one. The source and power of your present consciousness has never been physical. And where I am, many are not even aware that such physical systems exist. The physical system is an illusion, but you must accept it and from your viewpoint try to understand the realities that exist beyond it. The human race is a stage through which various forms of consciousness travel. Yours is a training system for emerging consciousness. Before you can be allowed into systems of reality that are more extensive and open, you must first learn to handle energy and see through physical materialization, the concrete result of thought and emotion. When you leave the physical system after reincarnations, you have learned the lesson, and you are literally no longer a member of the human race, for you elect to leave it. In more advanced systems, thoughts and emotions are automatically and immediately translated into action, into whatever approximation of matter there exists. Therefore, the lesson must be taught and learned well. The responsibility for creation must be clearly understood. To some extent, you are in a soundproof and isolated room. Hate creates destruction in that room, and until the lessons are learned, destruction follows destruction. In the terms of other systems, that kind of destruction does not exist. But you believe that it does, and the agonies of dying are sorely felt. It is not that you must be taught not to destroy, for destruction does not actually exist. It is that you must be trained to create responsibility. The control, the compassion that is finally aroused, and that final and last lesson, the positive desire for creativity and love over destruction and hatred. When this is learned, the cycle is finished. So mighty words, and I'm so much looking forward to. Yeah, you really can then choose yourself that the lesson is learned after you installed this material really deeply in every detail of your life and your daily experience, and then you can say yes, that's it. The teachers within your systems are those in their last incarnation, and other personalities who have left the system but have been assigned to help those still within. The system also includes some fragment personalities that are entering for the first time, as well as those in later reincarnations. Humanity dreams the same dream at once. And you have your Moss world. The whole construction is like an educational play in which you are the producers as well as the actors. There is a play within a play within a play, There is no end to the within of things, like the Marushka puppet. The dreamer dreams, and the dreamer within the dream dreams. But the dreams are not meaningless, and the actions within them are significant. The whole self is the observer and the participator in the roles. So here the question formulated is, in general, what is the purpose of this existence? And the answer is, in the most basic sense, the purpose of life is being, as opposed to not being. In your system of three-dimensional reality, you are learning about mental energy, also called thought energy or psychic energy, and how to use it. Knowledge about mental energy and its use is learned by constantly transforming your thoughts and emotions into physical form, your physical reality, and by then perceiving and dealing with the matter and events that are formed. From doing this, you are supposed to get a clear picture of your inner development, as it is reflected by the exterior environment. You should tell yourself frequently, I will only react to constructive suggestions. This gives you positive ammunition against your own negative thoughts and those of others. A negative thought, if not erased, will almost certainly result in a negative condition. Say to yourself, that is in the past. Now, in this new moment, this new present, I am already beginning to change for the better. It does not do to repress negative thoughts, such as fears, angers, or resentment. They should be recognized, faced, and replaced. Negative, distrustful, fearful, or degrading attitudes toward anyone work against the self. If you want to know what you think of yourself, then ask yourself what you think of others, and you will find the answer. True self-knowledge is indispensable for health and vitality. The recognition of the truth about the self simply means that you must first find out what you think about yourself subconsciously. If it is a good image, build upon it. If it is a poor one, recognize it as the only opinion you have held of yourself and not as an absolute state. You are not your emotions. They flow through you. You feel them and then they disappear. When you try to hold them back, they build up. You're independent of your thoughts and emotions. You use your thoughts and emotions in your mental composition. You must learn to trust your own spontaneous nature. Physical symptoms are communications from the inner self. Do not forget that you are part of the inner self. It is not using you. You must live in faith that your purpose is and will be fulfilled. The uniqueness of your own personality is to be cherished. Throughout the ages, some have recognized the fact that there is self-consciousness and purpose in dream and sleep states, and have maintained, even in waking life, the sense of continuity in the inner self. To such people, it is no longer possible to completely identify with the ego consciousness. They are too aware of themselves as more. When such knowledge is gained, the ego can accept it, for it finds its surprise that it is not less conscious, but more, and that its limitations are dissipated. What is the nature and purpose of dreams? A man's thoughts and dreams are more far-reaching than he knows. They exist in more dimensions. They affect worlds of which he is unaware. They are as concrete in effect as any building. They appear in many guises within many systems, and once created cannot be withdrawn. Through our dreams, we change physical reality, and our physical daily experience alters our dream experience. There is constant interaction. Our consciousness is simply directed in a different kind of reality when we dream, a reality as vivid as waking life. Dream action can be turned toward fulfilling constructive expectations, which will effect a change for the better. Dreams can be utilized creatively to improve health, gain inspiration, restore vitality, solve problems, and enrich family relationships. You can have pleasant and joyful dream that will completely restore your good spirits and vitality. In our dream life, we also visit other levels of existence and gain needed skills. The ego is not present in dream reality. The waking consciousness is not the ego. The ego is only that portion of waking consciousness that deals with physical manipulation. Waking consciousness can be taken into the dream state, but the ego cannot, as it would falter and cause failure there. When you take your consciousness into the dream state, you will meet with various conditions. Some you can manipulate, some you cannot. Some dream locations will be of your own making, and others will be strange to you because they belong to other dimensions of reality. Individual consciousness can be sent through systems of reality. This involves the transfer of conscious energy from a home system to an alien one. And certain automatic changes are made from system to system, involving the use of brain waves, certain patterns being normal in different systems. As the personality is changed by any experience, it is changed by dreams. We may forget our dreams, but they are always part of us. The dream's experience is felt directly by the inner self. Dreams have their own actuality. They do not exist independent of the dreamer, but they also have tangible form, though not in the form of matter as you are familiar with. They are forever contained as electrically coded data within the cells of physical organism. The dream universe possesses concepts which will someday completely transform the physical world. But the denial of such concepts as possibilities delays their emergence. So again, the dream universe possesses concepts which will someday completely transform the physical world. There are also shared or mass dreams. In these, mankind deals with problems of his political and social structure. The very energy and direction of these dreams will help change the situation. The energy behind a bad dream is the energy of hidden fears, which could be formed by anyone, since they are fears in anyone. Evil does not exist separate from the dreamer. And even illness or fear should not be seen as enemies, but rather as aids to understanding and means to greater end. In larger terms, there is no evil, only your own lack of perception. The words, "May peace be with you," will get you through any difficulty in other layers of reality. The ego, at any given time in this life, is simply the part of the inner self that surfaces in physical reality, a group of characteristics that the inner self uses to solve various problems. Even the ego, as we think of it, constantly changes. Each of you exists in other realities and other dimensions, and the self that you call yourself is but a small portion of your entire identity. Your prime identity is an energy essence personality, which is composed of energy gestalts. As each individual consciousness grows out of its experience, it forms other personalities or fragments of itself. These fragments are entirely independent as to action and decision, while constantly in communication with the whole self of which they are part. No individuality is ever lost. It is always in existence. What you call death is rather your choice to focus in other dimensions and realities. You do not acquire a spirit at death. You are one now. You adopt a body as a space traveler wears a space suit, and for much the same reason. In these other systems of reality, each of us has other selves, not an identical self or twin, but other parts of our whole entity, developing abilities in different ways than we are here. Their various realities merge in the overall perceptions of the whole self. There is a constant subconscious interchange of information between all these layers of the whole self. Ultimately, the inner ego tries to bring about comprehension by each of these selves about the other simultaneous selves, until the whole self is able to perceive its own parts simultaneously. These seemingly separate selves appear, to themselves isolated and alone. What is the nature of time? Time as you experience it is an illusion, caused by your own physical senses. They force you to perceive action in certain terms, but it is not the nature of action. Everything in the universe exists at one time simultaneously. The first words ever spoken ring through the universe, and in your terms, the last words ever spoken have already been said. This is so funny. The past, present, and future only appear to those who exist within three-dimensional reality. The past exists as a series of electromagnetic connections held in the physical brain and in the non-physical mind. These electromagnetic connections can be changed. The future consists of a series of electromagnetic connections in the mind and brain also. In other words, the past and present are real to the same extent. You take it for granted that present action can change the future, but present actions can also change the past. The electromagnetic connections were largely made by the individual perceiver. The connection can be changed, and such changes are far from uncommon. These changes happen spontaneously on a subconscious basis. The past is seldom what you remember it to be, for you have already rearranged it from the instant of any given event. The past is being constantly recreated by each individual as attitudes and associations change. This is an actual recreation, not a symbolic one. The child is indeed still within the man, but he is not the child that was, for even the child within the man constantly changes. Difficulties arise when such alterations do not occur automatically. Severe neurosis is often caused precisely because an individual has not changed its past. A change of attitude, a new association, or any of innumerable other actions will automatically set up new electromagnetic connections and break others. Every action changes every other action. Therefore, every action in your present affects actions you call past. No event is predestined. No destiny. Any given event can be changed not only before and during, but after its occurrence. An individual's future actions are not dependent upon concrete finished past, for such a past never existed. There is a part of you that is not locked within physical reality, and that part of you knows there is only an eternal now. The part of you that knows is the whole self. From within this framework, you will see that the physical time is as dreamlike as you once thought inner time was. You will discover your whole self peeping inward and outward at the same time, and find that all time is one time, and all divisions are illusions. Thus, concept of God. Note, Thus uses the word God sparingly. Usually he speaks of all that is, or the primary energy gestalt. If you prefer, you can call the supreme psychic gestalt God, but you should not attempt to objectify him. What you call God is the sum of all consciousness, and yet the whole is more than the sum of its parts. He is not one individual, but an energy gestalt. He is a psychic pyramid of interrelated, ever-expanding consciousness that creates simultaneous and instantaneously universes and individuals that are given duration, psychic comprehensions, intelligence, and eternal validity. Its energy is so unbelievable that it does indeed form all universes. And because its energy is within and behind all universes, fields, and systems, it is indeed aware of each sparrow that falls. For it is each sparrow that falls. So, and here follows some unsorted information. You are not the creators of the universe, but the creators of the physical world as you know it. When a person dies, having chosen their own death, also not consciously, You must tell the person that they are free to leave and that you joyfully give them their freedom. Let them know that they don't need to stay close because you realize that you will be reunited. Your expectations send telepathic suggestions. The self has no boundaries except those it accepts out of ignorance. Later in your time, you will look into the physical system at others in a position like yours now. Within your physical atoms, the origins of all consciousness still sing. The single line of physical experience is merely the surface thread along which you seem to travel. In actuality, following this analogy, there would be an infinite number of threads, both above and below your own, all part of the one inconceivably miraculous webwork. I am telling you what I know, and there is much I do not know. I know that help must be given one to the other, and that extensions and expansions are aids to being. There are answers to some questions that I cannot give you about the origin of all that is, for they are not known anywhere in the system in which we have our existence. Any personality can become an entity of its own. This involves a highly developed knowledge of the use of energy and its intensities. When a race is in deepest stress and faced with great problems, it will call forth someone like Christ. It will seek out and indeed from itself produce the very personalities necessary to give it strength. And here Jane Robert quotes Dr. Joseph Murphy, "The power of your subconscious mind." The power of your subconscious is enormous. It inspires you, guides you, reveals you names and facts and senses from the storehouse of memory. It started your heartbeat, controls circulation of your blood, regulates digestion, assimilation and elimination. When you eat a piece of bread, your subconscious transmutes it into tissue, muscle, bone and blood. Your subconscious controls all the vital processes and functions of your body. It never sleeps or rests. You can discover the miracle working power of the subconscious by plainly stating to your subconscious mind, prior to sleep, that you wish a specific thing accomplished. Here then is a source of power and wisdom that places you in touch with omnipotence, or the power that moves the world, guides the planets and their course, and causes the sun to shine. Your subconscious mind is the source of your ideas, aspirations, and altruistic urges. Whatever thoughts, beliefs, opinions, theories, or dogma you write, engrave or impress in your subconscious mind, you will experience them as the objective manifestation of circumstances, condition, and events. What you write on the inside, you experience on the outside. Whatever you habitually think sinks into the subconscious. The subconscious is the seat of the emotions and its creative mind. Once subconscious accepts an idea, it begins to execute it. Whatever you feel is true, your subconscious will accept and bring forth into experience. If you can change your beliefs in a split second with enough strength and intensity, and reverse yourself in the mid-air, so to speak, the results could be instantaneous. In trying to understand the concept of beliefs, I asked Thess the following. If I believe I can go up to a lonely mountain that nobody inhabits, and that in 10 years a beautiful woman with purple hair and purple eyes is going to fall in love with me, if I believed it strongly enough, then would it happen? Thess responded, if you believed it strongly enough, and if you did not find it easier to accept a woman with a different hair color, and if there were not a reason why you could not simply accept a normal love on a normal street corner, and if you're willing to offset all the other connections and believed it deeply enough, then go with my blessing. And with that, I'll end this presentation and hope you enjoyed it. Innen wie außen sind wir Licht, inneren oder wie ihr Leid. Riada, 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 innen wie außen sind wir Licht, inneren oder wie ihr Leid.